come to the June 16th meeting of the Regional Board of County Commissioners, and we'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Yeah, I know. Well, we have our guests today are from AmeriCorps, and we know that this class will be graduating next month, and so you're here to give us an update on the activities of AmeriCorps, and we're happy to have you. So when you speak, just introduce yourselves. So who's going to start?
You will. Start.
Okay.
So my name is Amanda Howe. I'm the program coordinator for the recovery section of the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program, which is the one-year initiative that's taking place this year. And we actually have a PowerPoint just to kind of go through some of the bigger events we've had this year, as well as some of the details. We do a report to community, which comes out at the end of the program every year, but we still have a month and a half left, so that isn't completed this time. However, in your packets, I did include a lot of information about some of the programs we've done in towns, as well as projects. So throughout the PowerPoint, if you have any questions, we're well represented here today to answer your questions. And we also have a lot of more detailed information in those packets for you as well.
So. Great.
And I might add that Amanda got recognition from the volunteer group over at HAC for the, you know, the Housing Assistance Corporation, along with several other AmeriCorps members for their work with that, you know, with the community and community service, which I think was over and above what you do, you know, for us.
Now, wasn't that the first year of working with HAC?
Yes,
ma'am. And is it mostly because of the foreclosures, or was it other things as well?
Absolutely. So we got a one-year grant to start this recovery program, which has six members, and they serve mainly with HAC. We do participate in some other projects with other organizations, but it's mainly with HAC. And it was in response to the economic downturn, so they do several things with the housing to help this year. So, but it was a one-year recovery grant.
Great.
So, okay.
Well, let's see.
I don't know. Will it be too dark if I turn?
No.
No,
it would
be better. Oh, that's
better.
Yeah,
much better. Thank you. Can you see that?
Yes.
So this is our a picture of our group from the very beginning of the year, and this is the largest group we've had. We have six recovery members, as well as two VISTAs participating in AmeriCorps Cape Cod this year, as well as the 26 members that we've had for the past 10 years. So. And there's a copy of this in your folder as well, but this is just to give you a better idea of the breakdown under the Barnstable County AmeriCorps umbrella of where the programs fall. As you can see, they have very different focus areas from one another. So the original program has, of course, natural resource management, disaster preparedness and response, and environmental education, as well as volunteer engagement. The HAC program has nonprofit capacity building in the area of housing assistance, which again is why they're serving with the Housing Assistance Corporation. And then the VISTA members are here within the county, serving human services, volunteer engagement, and grant writing and resource development needs. So this is just an overview of kind of the houses. So these are the members participating in each of the houses for the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program this year. And we do have one house in Wellfleet, which is provided by the Cape Cod National Seashore, and one house in Bourne, which is provided by Barnstable County. The focus areas for AmeriCorps Cape Cod are environmental conservation, disaster preparedness and response, community education, and volunteer engagement. And here are just some of the numbers from this year that we have so far. And as you'll see, we did participate in a couple of disaster preparedness and response activities this year as well. And then this is kind of just to give you guys an example of the spread. So part of the program is we have Monday and Friday group service projects where the members serve as part of a larger team. But then a couple days a week, members actually serve at individual placements where they can kind of get more in-depth into projects, and they serve with various towns and organizations. And this is just to give you guys an idea of how widespread the program is. And then some of these, the ones with stars beside them, are actually programs or placements that serve throughout the Cape or in various locations. And here are some examples of some of our large community events that took place this year. And I don't know if Becca, you want to say a couple words about any of these?
Sure. I can
your name, please.
Speak from here. Yeah, I'm Rebecca Wolfson, and I'm a program specialist with AmeriCorps Cape Cod in education and outreach. So I work with the members to plan environmental education, community education events, as well as our volunteer engagement, mostly on a large scale, but some small scale. We have a couple other slides on some of these events, but Martin Luther King Day, AmeriCorps Week, and Canal Cleanup are our large scale volunteer events that we do put on each year. Blitz Week is a member-driven project where for five consecutive days, students come out to sites in Harwich and learn about invasive species, native plants, and other environmental lessons while doing service in the field. So removing invasives, planting native plants, installing benches, and habitat restoration. We put on a tree education week this year at Meeting House Farm in West Barnstable, where for 5 days, over 400 students came out to the farm and learned about trees and native plants and participated in a reading of the Lorax and learned about becoming environmental stewards themselves. It was great. We've had a couple of groups come out and plant beechgrass with us in Falmouth and on Mashonee Island in Bourne, where they learn about the importance of beechgrass and dune restoration. And then plant some themselves. And we worked with Boy and Girl Scouts to teach them about disaster preparedness as well.
Excellent.
And so for Martin Luther King Day, typo in there, we recruited over 150 volunteers. It was a regional effort. We collaborated with the Cape Cod Hunger Network and the Barnstable County Department of Human Services. And the volunteers helped us staff food drives in 11 grocery stores across the Cape. We raised over 4,000, or almost 4,000 items to be given to the food banks across the Cape. And there was also a construction aspect of the project where some volunteers built food collection bins to be left in grocery stores and raised garden beds so pantries can grow produce for their clients.
One of the most important parts of that was the fact that people were asking, what kinds of food should we contribute?
Yes.
And the list that was given, I heard many people, was it Shaw's and Harwich, mm-hmm. and also Stop and Shop in Harwich, many people spoke about how important it was to know what foods were useful to, you know, to deliver. And I think that that list should, you know, should at least go, you know, perhaps be on the link to AmeriCorps so people could know about that.
Yep. Absolutely. And that was an important initiative that the Hunger Network and the Human Services Department brought to us and said, it's a pressing problem to have food in the food banks, but it does need to be healthy food. So education was a big part of that. You're absolutely right. An interesting thing to know about Martin Luther King Day is nationally for AmeriCorps, it's meant to be a day on, not a day off. And so typically, our AmeriCorps Cape Cod focus area is environment, but we're allowed to stray from that focus area to engage as many citizens as possible. And it's not typical that you can have an environmental project in January.
So that's a great thing.
Mm-hmm. And another of our big events this year is AmeriCorps Week. We partner with the Town of Barnstable Growth Management Department. Over 120 students came out throughout the week and learned about native plants. The project was to construct a coastal remediation nursery. So the town purchased a foreclosed on motel across from Craigville Beach, and their plan was to keep it as open space, and they decided to construct this coastal mitigation nursery. So 10 different species of native plants were planted in garden beds at the site, and they'll be transplanted once they're more mature to sites where they'll help with dune restoration or habitat restoration on sites around the town of Barnstable. And it's going to save them an enormous amount of money in the long run to be able to buy the plants now when they're small and transplant them later once they've grown. And actually, the Barnstable County had a good model for that with the county farm and the trees that they grow.
I think that was the week you guys pulled double duty, too, because you guys did help out at the Highfield Hall kind of county open house that we had for AmeriCorps week that week as well. I think it was the same week.
So just to transition back into the recovery program, again, this was a one-year initiative. We got an American Recovery and Reinvestment Act grant to do a one-year program, which has proven to be very successful. Members have served over 1,000 clients this year in various capacities, serving with the Housing Assistance Corporation of Cape Cod, not to mention different people that they've helped just through other projects that they've done at other organizations. So each of the members had kind of an individual placement where they could help address needs that the Housing Assistance Corporation had, where they needed extra assistance because of the problems going on with the economy. So there was homelessness prevention, housing consumer education, housing stabilization, foreclosure prevention counseling, energy and weatherization, and maintenance and repair. So members were doing everything from helping assist clients with, you know, filling out paperwork and things like that that they might not be able to do on their own, to actually going out and doing repairs and maintenance on some of the properties that the Housing Assistance Corporation owns, such as Angel House and the Village of Katamit. So these are just some of the different projects we did throughout the year. We also did a couple of builds with Habitat for Humanity, both at their Harwich site on Gomes Way and at Wellfleet. And we also assisted the Lorikeet Outreach Council. They started a community garden this year to help bring fresh produce into some of the different food banks on the Outer Cape. So that's the point of the community garden, is to help, you know, again, with the nutrition and everything carried over. We also did painting alongside members of Baybridge Clubhouse in Hyannis. They built a playground for the children living at Angel House, which is a Housing Assistance Corporation property. And then we did are planning to do some activities just to give kids at the Village of Katamit something healthy and fun to do for the summer. So we're going to do some educational activities with them as well.
I want to say a personal thanks for your help over at Baybridge. I sit on the Friends of Baybridge, and it was very important and very generous of you to do that. On July 1st, they're having a local fest on the green in Hyannis, and you're certainly welcome to come to that. Totally AmeriCorps kids that certainly would love to see them come by.
Great, great. They were really good to work with. They were a really good group. And I don't know if you're
about this time. Sure. My name is Greg Powell. I'm a grant writer at Resource Development Office, and I also supervise the VISTA program. So VISTA was also a one-year grant through the Recovery Act, and its focus is a little bit different. VISTA is an acronym for Volunteers in Service to America, and the focus is more capacity building and human services. The idea basically being to fight poverty in the country. So we received funding for two members this year, and one of them is placed at the Cape Cod Foundation, and the other is here at the county with the Human Services Department. Did we jump there?
Oops. She just got married.
Yes, she did.
Yes. I'm sure many of you have seen Kathleen around. She actually just finished her service because she was getting married to a gentleman who was in the military.
Unfortunately, she's going to Pensacola. I hope the oil doesn't catch up with her.
She is now in Pensacola and has actually already found a job directly through her service at VISTA, doing much of the same things.
Excellent. And Katie's been quite a bit around in human services as well.
Although she's placed at the Cape Cod Foundation, that they've really found ways to work together and sort of build on each other's efforts. So those are our two members. So talk a little bit about each project. Kathleen here at the county was working on the Mass 211 initiative. I'm sure you're familiar with it, but it's a regional health and human service helpline. It really eases the burden of 911, provides a lot of savings to the community, and a great service, you know, to people in need of human services assistance.
Greg, before you leave, that you should tell people, since we're on television, how they can access 211, because instead of in a situation where they need support from a human service agency, it is a way of finding out which particular part of an agency would be the one that would be the most helpful. So dialing 211 is something that is a, you know, is a great addition to the county and to the services that we owe our constituents.
Right. That's really all you have to do is dial 211, and there'll be an operator on the other line. That is, it's really a referral system. So there's at this point, I would say a little over 1,000 human service providers within the database. Available for referral depending on the client's needs. And a whole range of health and human service needs, anywhere from fuel assistance, questions about health insurance. It's really very, very extensive.
Yeah, it's a great service, and she did a great job with that. That it was very labor intensive, mm-hmm. and they did have to go around, and that's a partnership with United Way that right. we did, and it really, if we think of the cost of what we would have paid for that service, for that database to be put in, it the cost savings were amazing, and it is something now that people can just call and be directed to the right human service agency, as opposed to calling one agency, they right. referring you to another agency, and then they refer you to another agency. They really help you pinpoint that that find. So it is a worthwhile endeavor.
And although she went to Holy Cross rather than Boston College, we would have accepted her over there.
I'll leave that one alone. it is a great service for the community, and as I said, it really eases the burden for 911. A lot of people who traditionally would call 911 for example, fuel assistance can now call that number. The member serving at the Cape Cod Foundation was responsible for assisting with the establishment of a regional volunteer network. So this is an idea that the Cape Cod Foundation had, to just really consolidate all of the, needs and volunteerism in the region. The idea was to create a web page that had just pretty much every volunteer opportunity out there, and also a network of interested volunteers who would be matched up with those organizations in need. On top of that, the plan is to set up a physical drop-in site. Throughout their investigation, the Cape Cod Foundation found that a lot of people, especially our senior community, was more comfortable with dealing with people face-to-face, so they wanted to improve that aspect. I think Cape Cod Foundation recognized that the incredible asset that our senior population is here on the Cape. A lot of people are retired, looking to stay busy, contribute to the community, but really weren't sure how. And this is a way to facilitate that. That was the original design. Of course, it's now been expanded to include everybody. So, Katie Mueller was working on that. She did a tremendous job.
Great job.
And the website is up and running. She's now working on scouting out the physical location and just building the network, both the organizations in need and the volunteers who are looking to serve.
And if someone wanted to connect with if they're watching this and want to volunteer, would they just go to the Cape Cod Foundation website?
There will be a link on the Cape Cod Foundation website that can go directly to the volunteer network site, which is www.capecodvolunteers.com.
So as I mentioned, we will be getting reports to the community, the official one, out to you guys as soon as it's done. So we apologize for not having this today. We do have some numbers still coming in, so those will be coming to you.
Then I don't know. Maybe you had anything else to add?
Would you like to add? Yeah.
Well, my name is Ashley Luck, and I'm the program coordinator at AmeriCorps Cape Cod. And I was actually just coming by today to let you guys know about our graduation, which it sounds like you're already aware of, that on July 22nd, over at the Community College, we'll be hosting our, I believe this is the 11th year of AmeriCorps graduation. It's also going to be our largest, because this is our largest core. And so I would just like to extend a personal invitation for you guys to attend. And obviously, if you're interested in saying anything to the members, you know, just let us know. We can put you on that agenda. And also any community members who might want to come by and just celebrate service, that's what we'll be doing. So.
Well, I responded by email that I would be there.
I hope I did, but I'm putting it in my calendar right now.
I think they mean, because that year's graduation was one of the first events we put up on our shared calendar.
That's right.
So I sent that invitation to them,
yesterday. Maybe that's what
and
I
they can
do.
Accept it, and it gets put right in their calendar, so they're all ready.
So it works well.
Yeah. I do want to say something. I know you guys sometimes don't toot your own horn, I think, sometimes enough. But I'm always, you know, because I'm a numbers guy, I'm always impressed by the value of the service. And, you know, I think you have to say that service is invaluable. But, you know, oftentimes you have to put numbers associated with these things, especially when doing reports and things. And I see on the VISTA program, just for that 1 year of service, we're talking about a value of almost $76,000. On the 1 year of the recovery program, we're talking about $206,550. And then, you know, to top it all off, for the, how many years, 11 years of the AmeriCorps program, $9.5 million of service, almost 500,000 hours of community service. That's just a tremendous value to, you know, the citizens of Cape Cod in terms of public service and things that wouldn't get done otherwise, because the towns just don't have the wherewithal to do some of these things that you guys are doing. So I think it's tremendous.
Well, not only the towns, but and I hear your praises from wherever I go from the towns, I must say. So everyone is appreciative of all your efforts, and they love seeing you out there, you know, fixing those dunes and planting that grass. But the other important thing that your volunteers did for us is that, you know, there was the big NSTA herbicide issue, and one of the proposals that we put forth, which helped us have a moratorium to look at the wellheads, and it's the AmeriCorps volunteers that are going out and doing that mapping with a couple of members of the Cape Cod Commission, and this would never, it's a huge spread of land, it would never get done without them. And I know that Tom and I think it's Scott over there who's doing that with the volunteers are just really enjoying and appreciative of that work.
Yeah, he put in a proposal, and that was just, it was actually just selected, so he just learned, I guess, that he will be receiving a member next year that can be committed to that project.
Great, great, because they were a big help, and we were all like, oh, there's going to be a couple of months without them, and, you know, we're supposed to be done by December, so... thank you for that.
That's everybody huge. Loves nearly free labor.
Everybody loves free labor. Now, I have a project at my house.
It doesn't work that way, Cheryl.
Oh, I can't put my bit in.
I just wanted to say that in listening to your review of the year and the activities and the projects that the AmeriCorps volunteers did, is two things stand out, at least to me. One is that they are all self-starters. It seems like that's a prerequisite for being an AmeriCorps member, is to be a self-starter. And the other piece is their ability to recruit other people to be part of the projects, the volunteers, the providers, all of that. So my question is, how are the AmeriCorps members, how are they recruited or how are they selected? Is there a...
There's a national website where it's called My AmeriCorps, and so if you want to be an AmeriCorps participant, you can just go on, fill out the application, and you can click the different programs that you're interested in being a part of. But then, because our program is a little bit more specific, we have specific focus areas, so obviously we want individuals who are interested in disaster, interested in the environment, but we're also residential. So there's a supplemental application that when they submit the My AmeriCorps application, it informs us that this person wants to apply to this program, so we send out the supplemental application. And then once we receive that, we then begin interviews. And so we need both those applications before we can start. And obviously we want to recruit a very skilled corps, but at the same time we realize that this is service and that everybody pretty much has like the right to serve, and so we don't want to make it too exclusive where there's like this elitist sort of group that is all knowledgeable and all hard science or environmentalists. So we do look for a group that will be well-rounded and just passionate about serving and willing to dedicate their time to this program.
And not afraid of work. And some of it's very hard work.
You know, sometimes they figure that out along the way, but that's part of the member development. You know, it's like we don't ask that they commit to this necessarily, environmental field work in the future, but that at least for this year that they can commit to this community.
And some people find themselves, I would imagine. You're mostly are graduates, college graduates, is that the prerequisite, or can you be
involved? It's not a prerequisite, but the majority of them, I think, are transitioning out of college and into the workforce. So they see this as an opportunity to get their hands dirty doing some actual field work and
test
themselves. Yes, test themselves and see that they really love the work.
It's two, or comparative work experience. So we definitely have individuals who have it, completed a degree, maybe they're not sure what they want, but this is a great place for them to kind of come and figure it out.
And I always thought that was a useful place to be while you make your mind up to what you want to major in, not necessarily what you want to do when you grow up.
Yeah, we might need to go through the program.
Maybe yes.
And when does recruiting start?
Recruiting is over.
It's already over for
now. So
this
it
year.
Actually starts. I believe the posting goes up in the beginning of the year, so say maybe January, February time, and then depending on sort of what sort of applicants, like the numbers of applicants that we're having to process, will determine what the deadlines will be. So this year we had three rolling deadlines, and we just had so many applications that we knew we didn't need to leave it open.
Right. So. Yeah. Is that due to the economy, you think, a little bit?
They say, but...
So you know who your class is next year, basically?
We pretty much selected our... We're still waiting for some paperwork on, some final selections basically secures our seat. But we have, I believe, 24 of the 26 positions confirmed.
Good.
And two that are still open, waiting for their paperwork to get back.
And will there be an opportunity, I'm not sure if the grants will be available for VISTA and those add-on services that we were benefiting from this year?
We'll be taking a one-year hiatus because it was Recovery Act funding and the Corporation for National Community Service wasn't able to fund us this year, the year coming up. However, in my conversations with them, they were really impressed with the efforts of Kathleen and Katie, so... they've just sort of on the side indicated that we'll be looking at funding coming up, and that'll be a 3 to 5 year funding.
Exactly.
If you need any reinforcement on the value that Kathleen had here, Beth and I and all of us would be happy to
appreciate that.
To do what we can to promote that the value of a contribution here. It was enormous. Mm-hmm. And the 2-1-1 system up and running in the time that she was here was all due to her. I'd say 99% was due to her energy and effort to get that done.
They were both tremendously impressive.
Can I ask one more question? Sure. I've always wondered, how do you match, once you have your class, how do you match the individual member with the individual placement? What kind of process to go through?
That is kind of a tricky process. That's like the piece of the puzzle. That's always a challenge.
Yeah.
So I have been actually doing that for probably the last 5 years. And I mean, part of it is member interest. I ask that they look at the proposals that have been selected ahead of time and then write up a report or get back to me of what they are really interested in, what their top choices are, and then what they're not at all interested in. And hopefully from there, we can make a fit where nobody's getting what they don't want to do. And then we've had so many longstanding service partners that just sort of the partnerships over the years, we kind of know what works, what doesn't work, or what kind of experience they're hoping their member has, and so just try to do the best we can. It's a little bit like rolling a dice.
Do you get to the point where you have to flip a coin?
It's like you cross your fingers, but for the most part, we've had a lot of success, so.
Go ahead, Bill.
Well, I'm going to ask this question because we know what they give us. Mm-hmm. What I'd like to know, when you have your graduation, is what are they taking away? What is the major takeaway that those, because a lot of the folks stay, which is wonderful, but some of them are, you know, are leaving.
Well, in rare cases, spouses, I think. That's happening.
Well, we're hoping they're taking away an unforgettable experience. But,
well, no, I'm talking about they're in, you know what they as individuals, mm-hmm. you know, are taking away because mm-hmm. When we have the habit of asking people when they go off on different seminars and programs to come back and tell us, well, what did you take away from that program? What was the thing mm-hmm. that you thought was useful and valuable that you'll continue to use? Because there's a lot of conventional wisdom that goes in, you know, and stuff that goes with a lot of programs. But to me, it's important to see what the individual got out of it, because I think when we start to talk about it, and with others, we can say, well, we have this, you know, the opinions of people that participate in the program as to what they thought was useful and important. So when you have the graduation, perhaps you could ask them to sort of.
Well, I think one of the things that's, we do a lot of reflection during the year, and so we're always asking them to look back at what they've done and how do they feel about it, and I think it makes the biggest impact when they've actually been away from the program and they realize what they were a part of. And then I think just the experience of being so closely connected to local government obviously keeps them maybe, or we're hoping, more civically engaged in the future and more knowledgeable about how these processes work so that they can take what they learned here and go into their own communities and start to do, you know, their own service projects or event planning or, you know, community building.
Right, and how you have to go through, you know, boards of selectmen, or just to present yourself and just get permission mm-hmm. to do this or that or proposals.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's great experience.
And I think, you know, where that's sometimes reflected, Bill, is in the newsletter you guys do, Waypoint, which I think is tremendous, and I really enjoy it when I get a copy. Mm-hmm. I enjoy reading it. Usually they have recipes, they have all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
Your own little foxfire, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's terrific, and
We're happy to have you here and listen to your report. You can put me down to speak at graduation.
Yes.
I'd be happy to do that.
Yes.
Maybe show and build my old house.
I would just bask in the redundant story of what Pat said.
Well, it was such a fun program last year. It really was, especially the puppet show.
Great.
We will be here, and we look forward to it.
Thanks for taking the time to hear about this.
Well, we're glad you're managing the whole program and making it work. So,
right.
Yes. Thanks for telling us about
it. And Greg, thanks for your work in getting those grants done. The towns, we're getting more feedback from the towns of the support that Phil give for writing those grants. And it's an essential part of the services that the county offers to the whole region.
Okay. Thank you.
Right.
Well, good job.
Again, thank you and congratulations.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks very much.
I'd like to move the summary of action.
I'll second.
Okay, I have a question on number 19. To do the provide the plumbing and heating services for the Wellfleet House.
Yeah.
How involved is that? Is that like maybe a simple thing or is it a major thing?
This is kind of all-in-one on-call service. The house is owned by the National Seashore, but we are responsible for the maintenance and upkeep and that kind of thing. And we try to have a, in case something happens, call plumber so that the kids can call somebody.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Not have to try to figure out what they need to do.
Okay. All right, I'll call for a motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None opposed? Three in favor. Motion carries. Okay. For the record. Okay, who has the report? Anybody?
Yeah.
Bill?
This Monday, I'm happy to tell you that...
This past Monday,
Deputy Secretary of Transportation Rogoff mm-hmm. made a presentation of $250,000 for capital equipment, new buses, and perhaps one of the parts of that would be for trailers that could carry more bicycles along with the buses. We've got to figure out how to apply those properly. And $200,000 to the Cape Cod Commission for long-range planning to include looking at the rail link between Buzzards Bay and Middleborough, which is, you know, which is part of the thing that we're looking at. Secretary Rogoff was concerned that the was that the improvement of the rail bed between Buzzards Bay and Hyannis might be problematic with regard to say providing a commuter service. There was some effort to look at an MBTA commuter service for Friday, Saturdays, and Sundays from Middleborough to the Cape, but there were some problems with that. But definitely next year, that's something that we're trying to incorporate to see if there's an appetite for using rail to, you know, to get down to the middle of the Cape. So I was very encouraged, especially for the, you know, for the $200,000 for long range planning, for, you know, that the Cape Cod Commission is getting, because that's you know, that's a key part of us delivering our services to our constituents.
And the recognition of Tom Kerr.
And that too.
And the innovative efforts that he has made since he has been there.
He has been terrific. And by the way, there was one other thing, a couple of other things, but one thing that Secretary Rogoff spoke to was the evidence of the collaboration and coordination here on Cape Cod. Many of the in the National Park Service and other agencies, he said, we are, Bonneville County and the work with the National Park Service is an example that they're trying to use in the rest of the country, because we do work together. And in many other areas, he expressed frustration with the fact that down here, people seem to understand that you have to, you know, work as a team and cooperate in order to get things done. And we've given evidence of that, and as a result, we've been, you know, we have been getting these awards. So I think that, you know, the people, you know, of Cape Cod, Bonneville County, should be aware that we're getting recognized for the work that we're doing, and we're bringing more resources and assets here to the Cape because of that.
Because people are working together, and we are, in essence, regionalizing our efforts and collaborating, and so it's taking off even without...
Well, we know we have. Remember, we have several hundred regional programs that we've been running for many years. Mm-hmm. Although we have to remind everybody on a regular basis that we have regional programs that are running for many years. We certainly have been open to adding, you know, to that list. But we do require that we get the cooperation of the individual communities to support that.
Well, I think that, you know, more and more people are looking at how that does work. Most grants look for collaboration. Now you have to really network and have other people involved. And, you know, they're recognizing that the, and I think particularly this board, we promoted regional efforts more directly, and we're more willing to put forth our suggestions, and those are being recognized, and you know, they're attaching themselves to it. So I think it's a sign of the times, but it's also what will come out of bad times. It's a great opportunity where we do work together. So, all good stuff.
So that's what. That's great. Okay.
Michelle.
As far as my report of the week, I feel like I don't think I really do have anything to update. My only update was a conversation I had with Beth, but I think she talked with Mark about this, and we might want to just set it for the record as far as Children's Cove or...
Oh, you mean the question arise about, you know, our support, in quotation marks, for Children's Cove, and Beth said, you know, what, you know, this kind of question has come up, and I said, well, Children's Cove is a department of Bonneville County. So, I mean, there's no ifs, ands, or buts. And I think there was some question about, you know, they have their Friends of account, and that is a separate 501c3 so that they can raise donations and stuff that support pieces of the Children's Cove program. But the core function of Children's Cove itself has been, and I would imagine will continue to be, a Bonneville County department.
Right. If I can just also add to this came out of the... the amendment put forward by Delegate King to give in a very impromptu way, without it being on an agenda, without it being scheduled, without it being really within the proper process, And that didn't miss Human Service Advisory Committee.
It has and, raised
which
the
was my,
of many members.
Which was my warning when I sat there.
Human Services
yes.
Members?
Yes.
Human Services
yeah.
Services
yeah. Well, yes. as expected.
Right, yeah. as expected. Right. And I said that that was... But I think I'm going to recommend to them that this is a good place for them to come into charter review and discuss how that procedure went on and that process or lack thereof, and that these are things that have to clearly be defined in the charter of process, because it was a lot of the delegates didn't appreciate it either, because there was no discussion, there was no real forethought to it. They were put on the spot with a, you know, a needy case, and some people were thinking, like, why did Diane go there in the first place? And I said, well, she presented it to us. I thought, you know, she said, you know, I was thinking of going over the assembly. I said, I think you should give a report all the work you're doing.
Right.
You're doing great stuff. She never asked. All she was doing was
permission from us.
No, and that's what I said. I said, no, I think you should go and let them know what you're doing and how it works, and it really is a service. And an adjunct to case management in its own way, and lo and behold, without even asking,
well, you raised a good point about the initiation of ordinances. Should
yes.
they be executive decisions?
Or,
as the
maybe I would qualify that a little bit. Maybe ordinances that appropriate money
right.
may need to have.
The initiative.
I think the big objection yeah. for the people who voted against it weren't
yeah,
against
right.
Diane Casey Lee
no.
or the overnight to hospital.
Or
those are all great programs.
Exactly.
I think the issue was really one of process. People were not satisfied with the process.
It was a regional
right.
update.
And one other thing.
Thanks, Mark.
Well, let's finish this one.
No, we can't have a prize. The judges were very loud. They're rowdy.
Hello. Yeah, they are rowdy.
Hi, everybody.
How are you?
I've never been to one of these. That's why I'm here.
Oh,
good.
Excellent. So good to have you.
Oh, and
Mark is just finishing
And I would
up.
Say you'll never come back after this.
Yes.
Thanks, Mark.
That's right.
Well, are you?
So yeah, I would say you know.
I think we should propose.
Oftentimes, ordinances or motions that have to appropriate money have to go through a certain process.
Right.
With either the finance committee, blah blah blah, whatever.
It should have a more vetting. It should
exactly.
be vetted.
That's exactly right. You can't just kind of throw it out there and all of a sudden you're spending $11,500.
Well, I think that the real question is: should the assembly even be in the process of initiating appropriations?
That could be that's a good question too. Right? Exactly.
I mean,
you know.
It seems to me that appropriations ought to be initiated from the executive, not so much from
right.
the legislative.
They can suggest, they can bring it
right.
to our attention. And then, and even when we ask for appropriations, it goes before the assembly, and then there's a 2-week leg so that they can
it has
vet
to,
yeah, it.
Yeah. It has to go through a process.
Right.
Yeah.
So it was an improper process, and
it was because they were amending the budget, is what it was.
Well, that's true.
So this is why it was a bit of an anomaly.
Right.
But you could word it such that, you know, if it's anything that wasn't already examined as part of the budget. You can't just tack it on at the last hour.
Right.
I mean, it's kind of the thing.
Like the Congress does.
Yeah, like Congress.
Like everybody else does.
Yeah, like everybody else does. We're going to try to elevate.
The outside section to the budget. Yeah, exactly.
Elevate
ourselves. Okay, Bill, you had something.
There was one other thing. Last Thursday before the we went to that counselor's meeting that the governor came to, I was at an elderly housing seminar in Harwich, which had Lower Cape... I think it's community partnership for Murray, from, you know, from mm-hmm. Palmy Family Housing, and Val Foster from, you know, from Chatham Harwich, you know, our regional housing program down there, and they spoke to you know, some of the issues of getting on list, getting support for help with mortgage, and the importance part was to get your name on the list sooner rather than later. And to get, and if it looks like you think you might be having some financial problems going forward, to put yourself forward and access some of the help that is available. It was well attended. It was well over 100 people that were there, And we also talked about the potential for more housing in Harwich itself, so as elderly housing. And I thought it was a useful thing to go to. Anyway, that was the other thing. You might talk about the governor.
Well, I was just going to say the Barnstable County, the Cape and Islands Selectmen and Councilors Association met with the governor last week, and which has been his style recently, now that he's in campaign mode, to have more of a conversation than to actually speak and then leave. And the conversation centered a whole lot around the local option taxes, motel, hotel, rooms, and all of that. And he was looking for the association to say, can you agree on this? Because the whole issue is timeshares and rentals under 90 days, and they're left out of that legislation.
Right. That was the big complaint.
But it's a huge issue, because I know in Falmouth, we used to have over 2,000 hotel rooms. Now there's like 1,000 or 900, because they're all timeshares now, and you lose all that revenue from
that. Right, they're not taxed.
So the governor was very sympathetic to the concerns that the association had, and asked if they would be willing to take some sort of a vote, I guess, or some resolution to forward to him, to let him know that this is what we want, and they did. After he left, there was the vote. You were there.
Yes, okay. Dave Schroeder.
You actually, it was your motion, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so maybe you want to talk about it, since while you're here, we're on the topic.
You have to identify yourself, yeah. Please.
I'm Dave Schroeder, from the town of Eastham.
Former selectman.
Former selectman from there.
Still chair of the
intermunicipal group. Just here representing myself. But as I'm an adjunct member, associate member of that group. Mm-hmm. And I put in a motion to send to the governor, as he asked. He wanted to know that the group itself was supporting the idea of local option taxation, specifically room tax added to under 90 days, capturing condos that are rented, and capturing also the timeshares, which a lot of people are taking a straight motel. And the next day, it's tax-free because it's legal status change. He seemed to get that, but I've also been in his presence twice before when he looked like he didn't know what it was and then got it.
Right.
But so there's been nothing has really gotten to him for his signature, so he doesn't, it's not on his plate to have to act on it. But it was important for him to know that the group backed it.
You asked him, David, you asked him that question at the MMA meeting.
No, that was Austin Knight.
Oh, it was. So Austin was you.
Yeah. And that was the year before last and this year.
Yes, right.
Yeah, I mean,
but Cleon's been trying, Cleon has supported legislation, hasn't he?
He introduced the
legislation. That's what I thought.
It's his bill. Right. Supported by the Western Mass group and mm-hmm. supported by the Cape legislators, but not yeah. supported by cities.
Right.
The cities say, they don't have a concern for that. Right. For the outlet buying
and they have to understand what that means. I mean, somebody has to sell that. The other, if I can add in with the governor, Janet Jokum and I had a long conversation about job opportunities coming from the Cape Wind project. And, I have written to the governor saying congratulations, but considering this has divided our region, in a very bad way for several 8 years. If you took any of these measures, if not all of them, I think it might help mitigate and salve feelings. And it was giving a percentage of the jobs, maybe a rate freeze, some money, a funding stream for education to our schools, the tech and the community college and even maritime, to skill building, mitigation for cultural resources, impacts that might be on historical and cultural resources. And so she brought that up on a town level. And, what he kept emphasizing was this is Massachusetts jobs. This was jobs for Massachusetts. And even though he heard it, there really was not a going to, you're right, and we should maybe talk to the developers of Cape Wind and that sort of thing. So
I think his words were, "This is a private development."
This is a private development. Yes. So it's really
which wasn't his words when he was trying to promote it to get it in.
Right. And to me, you know, whatever anyone feels about Cape Wind, and even those that have supported it, my concern is that we're so ready to give it all away without an ask. Even though you see all of the benefits that are going to come from Cape Wind, you believe in those benefits. You believe you're contributing to the overall environment. It's a bigger and greater good. But you still have to be responsible for the people here, and think about your own community, and think about your future generations, and all of those very strident supporters really didn't put that on the table as well.
But the other question is, how many of the jobs are going to be just the construction jobs, which will go away, and how many are jobs that are actually going to stay here?
Right, and that's
how many of those jobs are there?
And that's where we need the education for maintenance skills, and to be able to have our citizens, our young, I mean, we have fishing people that are out of business and are trying to transition. We have the trades, and they would like to have these skills.
Well, I know that the workforce board is very concerned about providing training opportunities to do just that, mm-hmm. for the kids that are going through vocational
right.
training and
exactly.
all the four C's, and we need to get some support that there will be a job for people who are grown locally, trained locally,
right.
and are looking for opportunities locally.
Right, and
so that's all part of it.
And it's all about the green economy.
Well, I know that when the Cape Light Compact was asked. Or shown the concerns of small contractors in mm-hmm. the community, that we responded by
right away.
By
right.
giving more recognition to the possibility of integrating local contractors into the work that was done,
right.
and we did discover as part of this investigation that many of the people that were being used by the by the contractor were people who lived here. So the fact that we were able to discover that there were local people that were employed and involved might be part of this whole contract business, that you could have an off-Cape contractor, but there has to be some evidence that he's using local people. to do the work.
Right, and that is the case with RISE and the Cape Light Compact, and it would be nice to think that we could do the same with Mr. Gordon. So, anything else about the government?
No, I just, I had lunch the other day with Sharon News, the vice president of IBM, mm-hmm. that's been working
oh, yes,
with
right.
us, and Art Gaylord from Hui,
right.
and Teresa Martin from the Cape Cod Council. The idea was to kind of, because of the scientific institutions being in Falmouth and the fact that the areas to have Open Cape, have already been designated, all the various buildings. They wanted to kind of move to the next step, mm-hmm. just for thinking purposes, not any action. And it was pretty interesting because this Smart Planet program that IBM has, where they partner with communities and help them with their platform building of the data. Mostly data monitoring. And one of the things that Sharon mentioned was that they've been doing projects around the world that have to do with water, wastewater data monitoring. And we're also busy trying to get the planning to get wastewater in place that we haven't even gotten to the point of thinking, how are we going to monitor all this data? How are we going to monitor these TMDLs when we finally get something up and running? So that's a facet of it that we need to start paying some attention to.
Mm-hmm.
And IBM, they've, as I said, they've been doing it. They also have grant programs. They have something called, First of Its Kind. Cool. It's a grant program that IBM has, and particularly in the area of water and wastewater, innovative mm-hmm. kinds of data monitoring projects.
I know. Stuff
I know. Well, anyway, the whole idea is at least we know now that the attorneys have been meeting and that we're going to have some sort of an agreement for the use of the space so that they can begin to move on that. So, I mean, I'm not inserting myself
right.
in the planning process because they've been working a lot with Paul and Andy and all of those others. But it was just to provide some information from that end of the Cape because that community has moved a little
or has more institutions that that can benefit. Although I don't think Woods Hole and MBL are, would actually be part of the Open Cape because their need for speed and their need for data storage is so different that Open Cape probably couldn't meet the requirements.
On the other hand, Art Gaylon is a big supporter of Open Cape. Art Gaylon has been a big
supporter. Oh, absolutely. Oh, he's on the board of directors. Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
How do they satisfy their need now?
Oh, he was explaining that about data and data storage and the huge amounts of data that they have in the system at any one time. Yeah. They have a place in Boston on Summer Street, which is, I don't know who else is in there or what, how it works, but that's where a lot of their data is because they have to store it almost immediately, but they also have to be able to recover it immediately as well. So they have a building in Boston that is their storage center. It has to be off the premises, obviously, because, I mean, for one thing, they're not that far above flood level where they are down there in Woods Hole either, so they wouldn't dare store it in a basement someplace in the building. So that's what they do. Anyway, it was pretty interesting.
It
was more of an update, and it was Sharon getting more knowledgeable about local issues, and actually she's moving to the Cape full time now.
Oh, good.
I mean, they've had a house in Falmouth, but her husband's retiring now in New York, so they're going to be living there full time. I thought, that must be nice, and I said, well, so how does that work? And she said, well, my boss says to me, I don't care where you live. Doesn't matter where you live. Well, I mean, you work on planes and, you know, trains and buses and wherever you are.
Everybody's looking for off-site.
See, everybody does work, that, but...
My daughter does patient monitoring by using a computer, and she can do that any place. And the patient monitoring and the contact comes from experiments that they have. Instead of bringing everybody into a central... central core, you can basically decentralize, and that would provide more employment opportunities because a lot of people can't commute into a central place, but they can provide, because they have the skill level, can provide the service. Yeah.
Well, her title is Vice President for Big Green Initiatives. That's the program that she runs within IBM.
They're going to invite us back again up in Boston for another run.
Well, I mentioned that, yeah. that we had been to that meeting at Harvard Medical School.
And their other thing is called Smart Cities, and you can Google it on IBM if you want to look at it, but they really are looking at the Cape. I sat in on a couple of meetings over at the commission with their executives as they were kind of just hammering out how would they approach the Cape if we did partner with them in any way. And it is all of this, once we get different systems into place, such as if there are wastewater treatments, how do you monitor it, they have all of the capacity to do that. But they really see this region, and there is this concept of, we discussed it in the SEDS program, and we have that in there as far as our center of excellence. And they look at the Cape as a perfect laboratory, in a sense, of being able to be innovative, to do creative solutions, to be a area of excellence that can be a model for other places in the country.
You mentioned
so it's fascinating.
Program. Paul is coming over because I'd like to find out what progress we're making on the other 15 items.
Right.
Because we get Open Cape, we get that underway, and we need to see what we're doing on some of the other ones.
Yeah. And some of this is part of so he can give you an update on what they're talking about in that area. So it's very fascinating.
Well, and this has to be
promising.
Up and in place by January of 2013. So there's not a whole lot of time.
No.
And there's a lot of work to do. So. And the other question is the fiber's going to be hung as opposed to buried. And that's a lot of fiber to hang.
It'd be a lot of fiber to bury, too.
Well, yeah, it'd be very expensive to bury it. Yeah. But the other thing, too, is to let local communities know if they're
they open the
doing any kind of major major upgrades to roads that putting in the our bike paths, just putting in that conduit would be extremely helpful. Okay. You have a report for us.
I do, actually. I have a bunch of things, but I can tell you that I attended the town administrator's monthly meeting, and that was in Falmouth. It was at the Falmouth Bridge on last Thursday. We did talk about looking at doing human resources, elements of human resources on a regional basis. Mm-hmm. So we're going to contact the human resources organization that we have on Cape to see if there's some things we can put together for that. So that was very well received. And we also talked about the open meeting law and the changes on that. And I did get the presentation that Catherine made at the retirement. And I
think you did send it to us.
That was a really good.
It was, and I sent that. Really I shared that with the town administrators and Bob Lawton, distributed that to everybody in the group. So hopefully that's
was
helpful.
Was it sent to selectmen?
We could send it to anybody.
It might be. It might be. I mean, if it's it was good. I mean, it was.
Can I send it to you, David, and you can distribute it to the selectmen and councilors group? It's a presentation, PowerPoint, on the open meeting law changes.
Yeah, yeah, it was really well done.
Who's
Catherine Hesse.
Who's going to be the secretary of that now that Diane Keene is...
Is Diane still
on it?
Yeah, she's still going to do...
She's an associate.
Yeah.
I'm still going to be the secretary. Sure.
Yeah.
Because you could forward it to her,
right,
and she could forward it to the...
Diane. Okay, I could do that. Yeah, either way. Is Diane still doing it then?
Yep.
Yes, she is.
All right, I'll send it to Diane. I'll see you just so you have.
Yeah, good, thank you.
So that was... So that was what I received. And on that front for us, as you know, one of the impacts is the 24/7 meeting notice availability. Mm-hmm. I think what we're going to be doing is posting a large weatherproof bulletin board outside the building here, and that's where we'll post our notices for 24/7 access. So we'll be lit, all that stuff.
Didn't the Cape Cod Times have a story about that today?
I believe they did. Yeah, I didn't get to it, but yeah.
That we don't have our thing lit up yet.
Well, it's not until July 1st. What I've said in the interim, if we don't have it set up by that point in time, it's for people to post things in the front window and on the window when the door is up back. So.
Right.
So that's my report. I do need an additional vote from you folks. I need you to vote to allow the Pan Mass Challenge folks to use the County Courthouse complex on Sunday, August 8th. From 5 a.m. to 10 a.m.
And the Pan Mass Challenge is bike? And is that
triathlon? Yeah, they use it for a check-in center. And
is it triathlon that they're doing?
I don't know. I think it's the bike ride from Sturbridge to Peatown.
Okay. I'll move that.
Is that this weekend?
Is that the parking lot?
No, it's
lot?
August 8th.
They run it out of the parking lot. And they have a check-in area.
Did you second?
I'll second.
Okay,
all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed?
Thank you.
I'm opposed. We in favor. Motion passes.
You know, the Assembly is meeting today, and they are voting on the CMED ordinance.
Yes.
They know that. The letter with respect to the request for the Town of Orleans on the Massachusetts Estuaries Project, where they were seeking your support to do peer review of the process. That letter basically Andrew drafted and I signed and sent out, basically politely declined to support that. We think that's already been vetted. However, the town of Yarmouth did send a letter saying that they do support that aspect of it.
Right.
They addressed it to you.
And I did have a conversation with a person who's very involved in this in Wellfleet, Mr. Ned Hitchcock, who brought this to my attention, and he has some concerns as well, and I am in conversation with Andy about that, so we will get back to you on our thoughts on it.
And our letter did go to Orleans. It was CC'd to the same individuals and groups who were CC'd on the Orleans letter.
I mentioned it to the...
Did you CC that to them?
Comprehensive Wastewater Management Review Committee in Falmouth, and the facilitator was there from the Consensus Building Institute, because he's facilitating the public forums, and they agreed that the commissioners made the right decision, that this would have huge negative impacts on towns that are trying to move their projects forward, because the projects would essentially stop if there was going to be more peer review. And I think they also supported the notion that those TMDLs are not perfect. I mean, they're not exact, and it's not really an exact science. It's a
bit of an arc.
Yeah, and as towns begin to build develop their wastewater plans and move them forward, and how they're actually going to be built, whether they're big pipes or whether they're cluster systems or individual IAs or whatever they are, there's still going to have to be that monitoring, because it isn't just building to reduce the nitrogen level to a certain level, it's maintaining that level. So that's something we talked about with IBM too, is you have to maintain that nitrogen level over time. So the TMDLs are just really the guide, and it's the monitoring that's going to, once these systems are built, it's the monitoring that's going to guide the rest of it from there on. So no one saw that as a major issue with the science.
Right.
Even the scientists that would tell, who have also been very involved in this, agree that another peer review would not really be that helpful, and that it was better for the towns to move along with their plans.
Yeah.
According to Ned, though, there was some question about the gentleman and who has been very involved, and he does do the sampling in Wellfleet.
Oh, in Wellfleet.
So he has been, very involved for years. Felt that the peer review wasn't a peer review of some sort. So I have contacted Andy on that. We will have, further. I want Andy to hear directly what his points are, so that we understand where some of this is coming from.
Well, let me mention one other thing, too, is just to give you some idea, because I've been getting pretty involved in this whole plan in Falmouth, is the plan that Stearns and Wheeler did, the recommended alternative was the base. Well, that is now not necessarily the primary option anymore. And they're looking at other areas for disposal or discharge sites, actually. But the plan that Stearns and Wheeler did, the scope of work, the town felt that what they needed was a peer review of the scope of work, and whether or not that was actually put together, and whether the decision points in the development of the plan were the right decisions, such as using the base for a treatment center, as opposed to using other discharge sites within the town itself. Because it looks as though regionalization in the Upper Cape may not be very viable, because Mashpee has their own plan already, which is mostly clusters. Because if you look at the way the town developed, remember for 10 years, they didn't build anything because of that moratorium, because of the Native American issue. And then you have Bourne, who doesn't really have a lot of water bodies within the town of Bourne. And sometimes it's just a natural discharge into Buzzards Bay, which obviously, isn't the same as estuaries. So, and then you have Sandwich, which may or may not even have an issue. So building a regional plant at the base doesn't seem to be the first priority at this point. So what they've decided to do was to take those decision points, particularly related to discharge, and get some peer review on that, on the plan itself. So they're hiring two engineers, scientist types, I don't know who they are, to come in and actually peer review the plan, as opposed to the science, which is going to be kind of interesting. And it's not very expensive. It was $5,000. Doesn't even come under an RFP. RFQ. It's a phone call. Would you be interested in doing this? And they have two people who are interested. So anyway, just to give you some idea of how that process is moving forward.
Front-end feasibility, which is what, you know, what you've just described, mm-hmm. you know, is entirely different than the peer review
of the science.
Issue yeah. of the science,
exactly.
Which is what our letter spoke to.
Right.
Okay, but getting back to that, I'd like to, since we've already taken a position on it, perhaps we should share that position with the town of Yonge. Mm-hmm.
Well, they will they will get your polite declination
to the
town of
Orleans. List.
They were certainly CC'd on that.
Okay,
as well.
All right, that's all I'm sure of. Yeah.
And how's the wind doing over there at home?
Oh, well, let me tell you about that, because you know that there are some neighbors who actually live 1,300 feet from the turbine, and 1,100 feet is usually the standard. There are 6 families, but they're now more like 13 people. There are some others who have been included. And the town had already begun to address their concerns, so they had a meeting last week. The town manager, the assistant town manager, a council, not the town council, but another council, Vestas, the company, and their engineers, and their council was there, and acoustical engineers that are being hired by Vestas to check out the sound and all that. And all the people came, and it was a very, very productive meeting, and the people who were there, the people who live in that area, have agreed to partner with the Vestas acoustical engineers, and I think some were hired by the town, to provide information, to record times of the day or whatever. The town also agreed that when the wind reached a certain speed, they put a governor on the turbine and it would shut off at, I forgot, 22 or 23.
I think, yeah.
And it's I've only seen it shut down once because I live sort of below it, but it doesn't affect me in any way. Yeah.
I'd heard that at the industrial park, that one of the turbines that was put down over there, they put the blades on backwards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that it isn't in operation now, and we're happy that it isn't, because while they're doing all the acoustical engineering work on it, you don't want to have that other one running at the same time. So it's a good thing that it isn't. But that's where it is now, and so the people are coming together. They're being cooperative. They're going to participate in the study of the acoustics, and we'll see what happens.
You mentioned a specific distance. I believe that's the distance that's recommended by the federal study.
Well, I'm not sure who recommends it.
Okay, but the other piece is that in another life I was an acoustics engineer, that when you're looking at measurement of sound or noise, you have to look at several things, not the least of which is the terrain features and the part of the built environment that intercede between the origin and the place where you're trying to measure it, because measurement at the source and measurement at distance can be influenced by many things. If you have a body of water, for example, that acts as an amplifier.
Ambient noise. They're already determining what the ambient noise is. Like Route 28 is right above it, and you can hear all the traffic and the trucks, you know, heading to the ferries and going to all the stores. So the ambient noise also has to be looked at before they begin to and separate it from the turbine.
Very subjective thing. When we used to test subjects on whether or not they could discriminate and actually have acuity to access particular sound, is that people can focus and concentrate and actually hear things that not everybody hears, because there is subjective judgment that has to, you know, that's part of this. So absolute measurements sometimes run afoul of emotional content. So just keep that in mind.
My daughter, for instance, has very sensitive hearing. I mean, even from a little kid, she didn't like going into loud concerts. She still, you know, doesn't. She'll put earplugs in if she puts, you know, and she can still hear the concert. So, I mean, there is a sensitivity level. You know, ours, we probably had it too, but, you know, over time, our hearing has been damaged somewhat, so we were used to these sounds, or don't hear them as well as we used to. And so that is the issue, and in speaking to one of the selectmen in Wellfleet, he was saying, you know, they went forward, and then they nixed the project all the way. They permitted it, you know, said yes. And he said, you know, it really got to the point where, and this is where I was saying last night, they're looking for guidelines. They're looking for someone to have vetted most of this information so that they have something to go by to help them, because otherwise they're making the judgment, you know, well, it's too bad, you know, I'm sorry that you hear that, but we're going to go ahead with this anyway. He goes, well, what if down the road something does, you know, that we're the ones that are left to judge, to make that judgment.
But in the final event, if there's town meeting, they will be the final judge. And right now we have the example of Bourne has passed a bylaw to support it. So I think last night at your debate, I believe that the element of local control with regard to siting is an essential part of that.
It's an essential part of it, although some people look at that as being a stop.
But the other thing you have to do is decide.
We appear to be promoting, you know, let's say, one process that might shut it down throughout the whole Cape when individual communities can elect to go forward with it.
Exactly. And the other thing is, communities have to say, what kind of a community are we going to be? I mean, are we going to be one that is going to be totally reliant on fossil fuels?
Exactly.
Or do we want to be a community that looks to other energy sources?
That's
because, like in the town of Hull, I was talking to Andy about that last week, and they are 2 years away from going off the grid entirely.
Mm-hmm.
And the people in Hull love their turbines. And there are something like 200 people or 200 families that live very close to one of them. And they have just adapted to it.
Right.
And they love it. And they love the idea that they're going to be independent of the grid.
I interviewed a person that lives within the shadow of one of those turbines, and she said, we fought like hell against this before it came in, but now that it's here, it's perfect. And it turns out that somebody else who lived in that house wrote a children's book about wind turbines.
Right. Well, but the thing about Hull that makes them different is that they were able to secure their windmills and
wind turbines.
At a time when they were also able to get the power lines. I mean, they own
these
systems.
They're their own municipal,
so they are really giving a benefit to their residents.
That's right.
Whereas a lot of these, there's the promise of the relief to the municipalities, which will then hopefully extend
the
wrecks to
that,
relief
that
to the
Falmouth gets from that turbine have to go into an energy account. It can only be used, and it can't be used to pave a road or something like that, or pay a salary.
Right.
So anyway, that's. But this is going to be a long-term discussion over time. Anything else?
The only other things you know about the AmeriCorps graduation, because I already said we sent you that, and then I sent you another invitation on your shared calendar for the band program. That's the Barnesville Action for New Directions program. It's also known as the Drug Court Treatment Program.
Oh, yes.
And the graduation for that is Friday, June 25th at 1 o'clock over at Barnesville District Court. So if you wish to attend that, you're free to do so.
I did send that to you, so
wherever you pick up your email, I think if it comes in and you hit accept, it'll put it into your calendar.
That's a great idea, by the way.
My Comcast one as well as the Barnstable County one?
I sent it to your Comcast one, I think. Yeah, that's what I set you up, and you actually, the three of you are all up on separate accounts other than the Barnstable County, because that's mostly where you get your email.
Who actually sponsors this graduation?
Well, this is Judge O'Neill.
It's the judge's
program. I think this was started by Judge Reardon years and years ago. So this, the invitation's from Judge O'Neill, Judge John Julian, who's the presiding justice of the band program, and William Riley, who's the immediate past presiding justice of the band program. Oh. So those two I don't know, but. But Judge O'Neill was the one, basically.
He draws a big crowd.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's a good program.
I mean, if somebody was getting your name out there, they probably would want to go.
Right.
And that's all I have.
Is there any other business?
I have no other business.
No other business?
Do you have any other business?
Yes.
Yes. The Assembly denied the regionalization budget of, I think, $150,000 that was put in by the Commission.
Yes, a year ago.
a year ago, but effective July 1. And in their denial of it, some of the individual, some of them have said, we don't know what happens. We feel like we're throwing money into a pot and we don't know what comes back. So I said, well, some of the money that we have gotten, which came to the Cape Cod Commission for the police study as an example, in the combination of Orleans, Wellfleet, and East Ham, on some level, whether it's a full merger, sharing various kinds of work like prosecutorial activities, or any of those kinds of things. They said, you know, we don't know what's happening. We know that it exists, we can find it online, but we haven't had any kind of feedback as to what has happened. So I said, well, I chair that group, so I will be happy to come. And I was going to ask to get on your agenda first, because I believe you meet right before they do on alternate Wednesdays, is that
like
correct?
Today.
Like today, but let's say the next one or mm-hmm. soon thereafter. And bring a summary of what is going on and how that is developing, and also to indicate what next steps we think are appropriate, because this did not take it all the way through. It kind of looked at how much money you could save. It really focused on the savings and could you do it. And the concept is, yes, you can. You can save $1.3 million between three smaller towns. So it seems viable, but they also want to study further just how do we do this? How do we? I mean, there's different structures, different reporting requirements in one town versus the other two. East Ham goes to the town administrator, the other, and Wellfleet does too now. I think Orleans goes to the selectman. So all those kinds of things would be studied. So it would be at least an approach to say that coming forward probably from the towns combined as opposed to from the committee, since the committee is more ad hoc, would be a request for additional funds. And so I come here first, give you a brief presentation of it and what's going on, and then go to the assembly if I can get on their agenda as well.
Good idea.
Yeah. We can work on scheduling you to come back. You said their next meeting is?
2 weeks from today.
2 weeks from today, okay. Yeah. No.
The regional,
the assembly.
Yeah, the assembly is 2 weeks from today. That's right. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Is it actually 2 weeks from today, though?
No,
it's actually three weeks from today. Right?
Yeah, that's right, because of July
23rd, 30th, right, and then it'll be July 7th.
Right, July 7th.
Just by the way, before we leave the subject of them denying the $150,000, one of the things that they said in that denial, which they did not live up to, was if we came back at a time when we had budget money available, and we did, and asked for support to, you know, to put a, get behind a regional program, that they would support it, and they didn't. So to me, it's kind of disingenuous that they would give a criteria, we would follow it, and then when we followed it, they basically said, well, that's not really enough. Okay, so
information. They wanted more information.
Yeah. It is exactly that gap I hope to fill.
Just so you know, David, next week, actually, I want to talk to you about this. Paul wants to come over to do an NSTAR update, so that's what's going to be on the agenda for next week.
Yeah.
And then in July, we haven't set the date yet, I would like to have, we talked about this, Paul and the Cape Cod Commission come back and talk about, you know, the local technical assistance grants mm-hmm. and updates on all of those things, David. So, we could add SEDS to the mix, but really I wanted the LTA stuff, which was the police issue, the assessing got put into that pool. There was a whole bunch of things that they were doing on the with the local technical assistance money, kind of over the past, the year before and this year, just kind of, you know, give us an update on where all of those are. Some of them have wrapped up, and just so people know where we are with it.
Okay, but I am very concerned about keeping up to date with SEDS, is because right. I'd hate to have that sort of hanging out there until the last minute.
Yeah. I think that I put that on my list that we asked that last time. So. But we'll be scheduling that. I don't have it scheduled just yet. It could be in July at some point.
Okay. Good.
Okay, but the meeting you're talking about would be the 7th of July.
Right, then you would speak before the assembly. Yes, yeah, so yeah, we'll request that
fourth
would
is a Sunday,
be put on there.
Fifth is a Monday, right. Which seventh. We are closed. Right. Sixth is 7th of July. Yep.
Mm-hmm. 7th.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, so that's good.
I'll be there.
Good. And hopefully that the assembly will be able to schedule them on their agenda as well.
Yeah, so we usually meet in the afternoon on those days because it's an assembly meeting. Yeah.
So it'll be 1 o'clock here?
Well,
one or two, we haven't usually
one or
said
two,
it. Yeah, it
depends
on
it
what's
could
on
be,
the agenda.
Depending on what else we have to take up that day.
Okay.
It's anywhere between 1 and 2.
I'll firm it
on
up
an assembly day.
And who do I see to get on their agenda?
You know Diane Thompson?
Well, I've met her.
Yeah, you can send a request to the easiest email I can give you is aofd@barnstablecounty.org.
O-R-G. It's A-O-F-D.
Yeah, A-O-F-D.
At Barnstable County.
.org. And now I'll go to Jenny. And I'll mention it to Diane the next time I talk to her as well.
Any other business?
Just if you wanted to finish this
yeah,
piece.
Yeah, we're going
to
do that.
Right,
yeah.
Yeah.
Other than that,
no.
Any other business for open session?
No.
Then we need a motion to go into executive session and
come out in recess.
And come out in recess because of the assembly.
Right. I'll make that motion.
For the purposes of strategies for negotiating with non-union personnel. And
I second that.
Well, it's okay, and then we have a roll call then.
Lyons, aye.
Flynn, aye.
Aye.
Doherty.
Doherty, aye.
Okay.
Good to see you all.
Thank you very much.